Good evening, everyone. Welcome to standing Cape Cod Commission's meeting. Today is the 23rd of May, 2013. Time is 6 p.m.
I think you need to turn your microphones on.
Maybe. I thought everybody could hear you. All right, first matter on the agenda is roll call. Mr. Secretary.
Barnstable, Royton Richardson.
Present.
Bourne, Michael Blanton. Brewster, Elizabeth Taylor. Chatham is vacant. Dennis Richard Roy, present. East End, Joy Brookshire. Falmouth, Andrew Putnam.
Here.
Howich, Jacqueline Edston. Mashpee, Ernest Virgilio.
Here.
Orleans, Leonard Short.
Here.
Provincetown, Austin Knight.
Here.
Sandwich is vacant. Truro is vacant. Wellfleet, Roger Putnam.
Here.
Yarmouth, John McCormick Jr.
Here.
County Commissioner Mary Pat Flynn.
Here.
Minority Representative John Harris.
Here.
Native American Representative is vacant, and the governor's appointee is vacant. Mr. Chairman, we have a quorum.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, our point of order.
Yes.
Now that we have a meeting. How can you change the time of a regularly scheduled meeting of an appointed and duly constituted body without the consent of the body?
Madam Counsel, would you like to address that matter? Or Ms. Dietman, is he here? Yes.
I'm sorry, could you repeat the question?
How can the meeting time of a duly constituted body be changed, the regular meeting time, and it's safe to say that 3 o'clock has been our regular meeting time for at least 15 years. Mm-hmm. It's safe to say that it was changed from 3 o'clock to 6 o'clock. How do you change the time of a regularly scheduled meeting of a duly constituted body without getting the consent of the body?
The only thing I can say to that is, in terms of posting and things, we are able to do that, but certainly I think that's something that this board should discuss today.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, at what point will we be discussing this? At the end?
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
The next matter on the agenda is public comment. If there's anyone in the audience who wishes to bring anything to this body that is not listed in our meeting agenda, please step to the podium. Seeing none, next item is executive director report.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Our executive director, Mr. Nindwick, he's running a few minutes late, so I'll just start the meeting for him. We do have a few staff changes that I'd just like to bring to your attention. David Still, who's sitting over in the audience, is our new special projects coordinator. We're very excited to have David join our staff after an extensive tenure with the Barnstable Patriots. So he's got quite an undertaking with some of the 208 outreach efforts, so I'm sure you'll be seeing a lot of David around here. We also have Dave Sullivan. He's going to be starting as an applications implementation manager next week, and he's going to be helping the commission implement the e-permitting project. As you know, we have 3 pilot towns that we're working with across the Cape, and we're hoping to extend this to as many additional towns as possible over the next few years. We also have Brett Whiteley. He's going to be a new GIS analyst starting closer to July, so you'll probably be seeing a few new faces around here as well. We had a great Smarter Cape Summit last week at the Cape Codder, and we had quite a great attendance. And there were quite a number of great presentations that took place at that Smarter Cape Summit. Finally, we did receive the notice to proceed on the 208 wastewater plan. So we are certainly in full swing on that plan right now. So if Paul comes in a little bit, he may want to address a few other items with you, but that's all I have for now, Mr. Chair.
Thank you. Next item on the agenda, the minutes for April 11, 2013.
Move to accept them.
Second.
Second.
It's been moved and second.
Mr. Chairman, I have a correction.
Yes.
Mr. Chairman, I have a correction. On page 4, second paragraph, it quotes me as saying that the federal government aggregated their duty. I think the word I meant to use, if I didn't use it, either I was misquoted or I misspoke, was aggregating.
That's what I heard.
Abrogating, excuse me. Abrogating the duty.
I'll move the minutes as amended.
I'll second that.
All right, it's been moved and second that the amendments approved by Mr. by the Vice Chair be incorporated minute change. Are there any further comments? Recommendation none. All those in favor, state so by saying aye.
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 Abstain. Objection. Thank you. Moved. The next item on the agenda is a public hearing. This public hearing is the Martha's Vineyard Hybrid Cable Project. The final hearing draft decisions is continued from the 14th of May. Is anyone here, staff? Oh, I couldn't see you, I'm sorry.
I believe, pardon me, for the record, my name is Andrea Adams. I'm the Cape Cod Commission Senior Regulatory Planner. I believe you have sheet in front of you to ask the subcommittee to vote on a set of minutes.
Okay, I was looking for you because I couldn't see you through the pole there, and I was on the verge of panicking that we didn't have the staff here. So it should be noted that the hearing is being recorded. The purpose of the hearing is for the Cape Cod Commission to serve and take testimony on the limited DRI application and the draft decisions for Comcast and InStar proposing a submarine telecommunication an electrical cable from Falmouth to Martha's Vineyard. We will be entertaining a presentation of a draft decision by commission staff and presentation comments by the applicant, questions from the commission members, and public testimony. Would you like to proceed?
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
I believe I'd like to ask the subcommittee to approve the minutes of the last subcommittee meeting?
Yes, you're correct. I should continue on, should I? Would you ask the subcommittee to vote on the draft minutes, please?
Okay, I'd like to ask the subcommittee please vote on the draft subcommittee minutes of the last meeting.
Second the motion.
Okay, second. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, we abstain. Thank you.
Thank you. Commission staff is now to present the written draft DRI decision.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. For the record again, my name is Andrea Adams, Cape Cod Commission Senior Regulatory Planner. I just have one additional handout that I'd like to give the board members before we start the presentation.
Thank you.
the record that you have a series of information that was provided to the subcommittee, to the commission members who are not part of the subcommittee in our new method via a thumb drive. If any of you still have them, you're welcome to turn them back in and we will reuse them. My presentation will cover the project description briefly, commission jurisdiction, standards and review, committee analysis of the project, and subcommittee recommendations. In terms of the project description, which you can see on the screen behind me, it's a new 4.5 mile submarine hybrid fiber optic electric cable from Falmouth to Martha's Vineyard. The Falmouth landing site is a municipal parking lot at the intersection of Mill Road and Beach Road Surf Drive. The installation involves use of a technique called horizontal directional drilling, or HDD for short. The seagoing cable will be laid via a cable ship or barge, and the cable will be laid in one continuous length using cable trenching, remotely operated vehicle, or a hydro plow. In terms of the commission's jurisdiction, it qualifies under section 2D little I of the enabling regulations. It's a DRI because it required the preparation of an environmental impact report. And also the subcommittee previously scoped the development of regional impact or DRI review to limit the review to coastal and marine resources, regional policy planning issue areas. And the scoping decision, which is a decision on its own separate from the one that you're looking at tonight, also includes a condition that requires use of sediment controls during construction on the land side work. In terms of the standards of review, they're in section 7C8 of the enabling regulations. The criteria for approval are consistency with the Commission Act, the Regional Policy Plan and its Minimum Performance Standards, or MPS, any applicable districts with critical planning concern, or DCPCs, municipal development bylaws, Commission Certified Local Comprehensive Plan, if there is one, and that the probable benefit of the project must be found to outweigh the probable detriment. And one of the ways the subcommittee and the full commission can try and determine that is to see whether or not the project meets any best development practices or BDPs in the regional policy plan. In terms of the two issue areas, the first is coastal resources. The project involves disturbance within 100 feet of a coastal wetland resources, but because they're using horizontal directional drill, they can extend the conduit for the new cable approximately 2,600 feet seaward to avoid any impact to coastal and nearshore resources, including those eelgrass beds. Also, use of this technique avoids what's called a time of year or toy for short restriction per the Mass Division of Marine Fisheries to protect fish resources. And the HDD fluid is primarily bentonite clay with some other stabilizers, and the applicant has best management practices in place to contain releases of the bentonite during the drilling procedure. They're also not going to refuel any equipment within 100 feet of marked wetlands. That includes private vehicles, small trucks, or the HDD machine itself. And the co-applicants there, Comcast and NSTAR, have an emergency response plan for spills, both on the land side and in the water, and they will use construction best management practices for erosion and sedimentation controls, particularly around the land side part of the work. Also, the project construction period, which is going to be approximately April, May, through October, is going to avoid the busiest recreational periods. The subgrade cable will not interfere with public access to coastal resources because it's going to go under them and come up in the sound, and then the hydroplow is going to take it from there and continually bury it. In terms of marine resources CR210, subcommittee also notes that utility installations in coastal resource areas and buffer zones is allowed where there's no feasible alternative route and there's no disturbance. They did extensive eelgrass surveys, and one of the things that came to the people that weren't on the subcommittee via the thumb drive was a copy of the single EIR, which included the results of those surveys, both photographic evidence and other narrative discussion of the results to show that they're not going to be impacting that eelgrass. And the use of the hydroplow does create temporary impacts in the sound, but there are no time of year restrictions because of the use of horizontal directional drill in the near shore and other measures that avoid impacts to fish, shellfish, and crustaceans. In terms of marine resources, which is a relatively new section of the regional policy plan, the subcommittee notes the project occurs within the jurisdictional area of the Cape Cod Ocean Management Plan and the Massachusetts Ocean Management Plan, and it also occurs in the planning areas of areas identified as special sensitive and unique, or SSU, and high human use activity areas per the Massachusetts Ocean Management Plan. In terms of marine resources, the cable location will not interfere with navigation. Again, that's primarily because it's going to be buried once it's laid, as opposed to sitting on the sea bottom. Again, to reduce interference with recreational boaters or steamship authority routes, cable installation will occur approximately between October and May. The applicants are also going to coordinate with the U.S. Coast Guard Steamship Authority to prevent interference with boats. There was also commentary during the public hearings or recommendations that they also seek out contacts in the local area for hook fishermen or scallop draggers that might also use that area of the sound so that they could work with perhaps the harbor masters or other groups to also avoid those areas. In terms of other marine resources considerations, they have an operations and management plan that's been provided to address any time of year restrictions, and that includes development activity will be operated and maintained so as not to constitute a threat to public health and safety and the environment. And they have to show that they have adequate capital or insurance to make necessary repairs, including repairs on accounts of accidents, collision, and natural disasters. In terms of one particular part of their O&M plan, they have going to have an environmental remediation contractor for releases or spills, and they're also going to have an environmental field monitor primarily for the seaward work that will have stop work authority should they determine that there are protected marine species within either the work area or for larger marine species within 2 miles of the work area. And again, you can see that on the slide behind me. This specific minimum performance standard states that installation must cease if northern Atlantic right whales are observed within 2 miles or marine mammals are observed within the work area. And the minimum performance standard marine resources 1.9 talks to protection of sea turtles. In consultation with the Division of Marine Fisheries, which is DMF, the DMF determined that no time of year restrictions were required, but again, that environmental field monitor is going to be trained to comply with this requirement and have stop work authority. Again, in terms of marine resources, the applicant conducted marine surveys in 2011. Again, they are primarily avoiding eelgrass by plunging below it and emerging well beyond it. The cable route also avoids what's called complex bottom, which could be rocks or extrusions coming out of the bottom or any historic or archaeological resources. They did surveys and worked with the state agencies to ensure that the cable route wasn't going to essentially go through a shipwreck that might be there. The only concern of the subcommittee is that the hydroplow work occurs within 100 feet of eelgrass beds on the Falmouth side. And as such, the draft decision before you includes a condition that the co-applicants shall provide a site monitoring plan for the hydroplow work. Another concern for marine resources is the project area is mapped for terns and plovers. However, the state agency that deals with these issues, Massachusetts Natural Heritage and Endangered Species Program, issued a no-take determination on that date this year. So even though it's mapped, there's not going to be a take by the work that they're doing. In terms of, I beg your pardon, it should say subcommittee analysis. In terms of marine resources 1.17, that's a specific minimum performance standard that deals with a public benefit. It's separate and distinct from the prior test that I talked about earlier in my presentation about benefits and detriments. This particular finding states that there has to be a public benefit found by the project. And Marine Resources finding 15 indicates that the subcommittee found for this particular minimum performance standard that the public benefit of the project does outweigh the cumulative adverse impacts to protected resources by the offshore development. In terms of Marine Resources 118, that seeks to coordinate crossings, and the subcommittee notes that the route is in an area of existing cables. However, testimony in the record indicates from the applicant that several of those cables have either failed or are in danger of failing, primarily because they are spliced cables. This particular cable is not going to be spliced. It's a continuous run from end to end, so it's not going to have that potential failure problem. And it also bundles two in one. It's not just a telecommunications cable and then potentially having to run an electrical cable or vice versa. It brings both from Falmouth to Tisbury. And in terms of Marine Resources, which I touched on earlier, they did survey work in 2011, and they did work and will continue to work with the Marine Board of Underwater Archaeological Resources, which deals with archaeological resources under sea bottom in case they should encounter any during cable laying. In terms of other approval criteria, other than consistency with the minimum performance standards, again, the first is that the probable benefit of the project must be found to be greater than the probable detriment. The regional policy plan indicates that the commission at its discretion may consider if a project meets a best development practice that exceeds a minimum performance standard in its analysis of benefits and detriments. The subcommittee identified two. One is in the land use section, and even though land use wasn't specifically part of the limited scope, the subcommittee did vote that this meeting this particular best development practice could be seen as eligible as a benefit, and its co-location of public infrastructure. And again, that gets to the fact that the cable is bundled, bringing both electricity and fiber optic telecommunications in one line. The other best development practice that the subcommittee found that the project met is best development practice Marine Resources 1.29, and the co-applicants have provided a multi-hazard plan. In terms of consistency with the commission-certified local comprehensive plan and municipal development bylaws, Falmouth has a 1998 commission-certified LCP, and in your materials, you would have seen a copy of a May 7th, 2013 email from Brian Curry, the Falmouth town planner and DRI liaison, indicating, as far as he was able to determine, that the project is consistent with these two criteria. And I would note for the record that both Mr. Curry and Jennifer McKay, who is the conservation administrator of the town of Falmouth, and the Conservation Commission was the referring body in this case because they have to grant the project an order of conditions. They were both made aware of this hearing and provided copies of the draft decision, the same one that you have in your packets. As of 5 o'clock today, when I left the office to come over here, I had not received any correspondence from the town either way on the draft decision. In terms of consistency with districts of critical planning concern, or DCPCs, in your record you should have an April 3rd, 2013 email from Mr. Curry that the project is not located in the district of critical planning concern, and that includes both the landfall and the sea-based part of the cable. In terms of subcommittee recommendations, those are conditions are laid out in your draft decision. I just would point out a few for the benefit of the commission members who weren't on the subcommittee. The draft environmental construction management plan, that's what ECMP means, is going to be required to be augmented to ensure that spills on land and in the water are addressed. They did provide a draft, but commission staff would like to look at it some more in terms of making sure that it's consistent with all the requirements. Sedimentation control plan will be submitted before construction starts. A noise mitigation protocol for seaward work must be provided to the commission. We must receive certification for the environmental field monitor relative to the right whales that they have been trained to observe for the presence of these marine mammals. And the co-applicants must provide the commission with evidence that they have adequate capital and/or insurance to respond to contingencies emergencies or repairs. And the only thing that I would bring to your attention as well, that's a change, a material change from the draft decision that was mailed to you, or emailed to you, or provided to you on the thumb drive. That's that one page that I handed out with the red and white text, or red and blue text. The plan that you see crossed out in blue is a plan that was provided in the original DRI submission. Since then, they've made some updates, primarily with respect to manhole locations and for the staging area, to allow people to continue to access the public parking lot in such a way that they can do their horizontal directional drill and set it up facing toward Vineyard Sound. But there's only one entrance to that parking lot, and they wanted to shift where the machinery was so that people could still get in, get around their particular work area, and park in the rest of the parking lot and still enjoy the amenities along that part of the shoreline. So those are the two most recent plans are shown in red that were submitted by email to commission staff, and they were also, I believe, included in the materials that were sent out for this meeting. That's all I have at this point for our presentation. Thank you for your patience.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
Can I have a couple of clarifications?
I'm sorry?
Can I ask for a couple of clarifications or corrections?
Sure.
Just one thing, sorry. I think one was the construction period. I think.
You should introduce yourself.
Les Smith from Epsilon Associates, environmental consultant for NSTAR and Comcast. I believe Andrea accidentally said that the construction period was between April 15th and October 15th, where in actuality it's between October 15th and April 15th. So it's in the winter months, not the summer months. And also, another clarification on the moving of the HDD for the plan. It wasn't so the public could gain access to the parking lot, because the entire lot would be used by NSTAR and Comcast for the HDD staging. It was so that equipment could get around the HDD drill rig. So just a clarification there. Thank you.
Thank you. The applicant is now invited to make a presentation and comments.
We gave a presentation back in April to the same body here. I don't see the need to go through that again. We have it on the computer, so if there are any questions and answers come up in the next portion of the session, we'd be happy to go to sections of it and address those as required.
You indicated that there was a presentation to the full commission or just the subcommittee?
Subcommittee.
It was the subcommittee.
It's a subcommittee? Okay. It was previously in the subcommittee.
Well, there's the other members here that should not be denied the opportunity to.
A copy of that particular PowerPoint, which goes through how the project meets or does not meet the particular minimum performance standards, was also provided to commission members who were not on the subcommittee as part of the materials that were on the thumb drive.
I think that if there are members here who would like to see all the part of this, they should be afforded that opportunity. Are there any members like to have a full or partial presentation of their? Seeing none, we'll proceed.
Thank you. Thank you.
Are there any others from the federal, state, or the town who wish to comment? Seeing none, thank you. Are there any other comments from the, final comments from the applicants?
None from us.
Sorry?
No comments from us.
Are there any final comments from the commission staff?
No, sir, thank you.
Mr. Chairman.
Wait a minute.
I'm sorry.
Yeah, I was going to ask, are there any comments, questions from my colleagues in general? Seeing none. Yes?
I was going to say, Mr. Chairman, we have the public, though there's no public, I think we have to technically ask for public comment.
Yeah, I may have overlooked that word. Yes, thank you. I spoke of everyone but the public. Are there any, simply because I looked out and saw there was no one from the public, are there any one from the public who wish to comment? Seeing none, we'll proceed. I would now entertain a motion to close the public hearing and direct.
Yes, I move. Second.
It's been moved and seconded that we close, the public hearing and direct. Comments, remarks? Seeing none, all those in favor, say so by saying aye.
Aye.
Oppose? Abstain? Thank you. Now, propose a motion on the draft of written decision.
Mr. Chairman, if I may, I move that the limited DRI decision be accepted and adopted as drafted and amended.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. The motion that the limited DRI decision be accepted and adopted as drafted. All those in favor? If there are no comments, all those in favor, please state so by saying aye.
Aye.
Oppose? Abstain? Thank you. Motion is passed. Thank you. Next item on the agenda is nomination and election of new officers. For the chair of the commission.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
I would like to state that the Cape Cod Commission nominating committee had a meeting at 9 a.m. on May 17, 2013. The committee reviewed and provided the process of selecting new Cape Cod Commission officers for the term of July 1st, 2013 to June 30th, 2014. The committee voted to present the slate of candidates to the commission in this order. Chairman John McCormick, Vice Chairman Richard Roy, Secretary Andrew Putnam. Nominating committee, Ernie Virgilio, Len Schott, Richard Roy.
Mr. Chairman, I'll move the nominations be closed.
Second.
Mr. Chairman, I move the secretary cast one ballot then.
Yes, it is. Been moved that the nomination be closed.
I'll second that other part too.
Thank you. It's been seconded, and all those, if there are no objections, all those, please state so by saying aye.
Aye.
Oppose? Abstain? Thank you. We will now present the recommendation on the slate. All those in favor? Is there a motion?
I believe the secretary cast one ballot on that.
Yeah.
Oh, I didn't hear
it. Authorized cast one ballot, please.
It was moved that the secretary cast one ballot.
Okay.
Acceptance. And I think it was seconded.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay, so it's a move and second. Secretary, all those in favor? If there are no objections, please state so. I say aye.
Aye.
What were we voting on there?
Huh?
What were we voting on there?
On the slate of.
Well, we authorized the secretary to vote.
Yeah.
That was the vote to authorize the secretary to vote.
Okay. Excuse me.
It's a protection.
Sorry?
It's a protection.
Yes, thank you. I wasn't even thinking about it. Trying to get through the meeting here. The next item on the agenda is other business we wanted to discuss.
Mr. Chairman, I would like to speak before Mr. Austin takes the floor, because I would like to thank the outgoing officers for their services for the last year, particularly the chairman, who has done an outstanding job of keeping order in this rather disorderly group.
We accept. Thank you.
I yield to Mr. Austin.
Mr. Chairman, not to make your night much longer, however, I'm concerned about the change of the meeting from 3 o'clock to 6 o'clock without the participation of the commission members. When Gail called me, I almost shot the messenger, but I apologized. And when I saw you the other day, I expressed my concern. And I think something as considerable change as this should come before the committee. And I feel very strongly on that, and I do believe we should go back to 3 o'clock. I understand this is a pilot, as presented, but for my opinion, the pilot has failed, and I'd like to see it go back to 3 o'clock. And I'd certainly just express myself in that way.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
Okay. I've been sitting here for quite a few years, and I had mentioned to my wife that going to a full commission meeting, and she said, oh good, usually you're home about 6, 6:37, we'll have dinner, we'll go out for dinner. I said, no. And she said, what do you mean? I said, well, the meeting's not till 6. Well, you know, I've been married a long time, and she questioned that as to where I was really going. So, I have to state that this is not a good idea.
Mr. Chairman.
I know.
Oh.
Sir Rosen.
I think the decision to do this was not entirely without commission knowledge and interest. And one of the things that some of our committees that we've been trying to address is the lack of participation by the public in coming to our meetings. And we thought we would try to do some different things to see whether it made any difference. I don't know, based on tonight's meeting, whether the time change to the evening would make any difference or not, mainly because it's really not a hot topic. But I just think that we ought to be open to try to make, you know, our work is available to the public, because we are absolutely committed to serving them. And of course, we can do it at 3 o'clock, obviously. And if they're really interested, they'll be there. But there are many people that can't be there at 3 o'clock. So I just would say that. I don't think we ought to beat everybody up just because, you know, we did it. I'm not sure if we did it right or wrong. It seemed reasonable. And so that's what I'd like to say.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
I believe that putting it at 6 o'clock was probably a good thing, not only just to get the discussion rolling. You know, we have two problems, you know, we need to deal with. One is membership retention. We have a lot of vacancies. We have some vacancies that seem to never get filled, as far as I can see. And we also, of course, need, as was already said, we need the public to show up. And tonight was a light meeting, so this probably wasn't a good indication, again, of whether the public would appear here. But the average person on Cape Cod is working from 9 to 5. And a 3 o'clock meeting doesn't fit in for the average person. The average person is it's what we want to fill this room. We want the average person sitting there giving public comment on these projects, but we're not really getting that a lot. And share some hot topic issues, real hot topic issues, as I've already gotten a taste of, do generate people coming out at 3 o'clock, regardless of whether, you know, that's normally their working time or not. But I think that we at least need to have that discussion about the meeting time, because that factors into those two items that we really need to start addressing, which is how do we get more people to fill those vacancies, and how do we get more people to show up and participate when we have our meetings. Like I said, I'm just glad that the discussion is rolling. So.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes.
I hate to disagree, but one of the reasons why people don't show up at the meetings is that something is going on they're not particularly interested in. If they were interested in, they'd show up. They do. Number two, and perhaps more important, the reason, or one of the underlying reasons why vacancies are not filled, is because the selectmen of the various towns on the Cape do not perceive that the Cape Cod Commission is of value to them. If they did, they would find ways of making the appointments that are necessary. There are people out here and the towns who would serve if they were asked to. And I think the selectmen, it is an obligation on the part of the selectmen to actively seek, not merely passively wait for somebody to show up and say, I want to come. It's up to the selectmen, and one of the reasons why the selectmen don't actively seek it is that in some measure, the selectmen of this Cape do not altogether trust that the Cape Cod Commission is going to be acting always in their best interests. And that's an issue that we have to deal with, and an issue we have to face. But we don't face it by changing the meeting so the members won't show up, which is what's going to happen if you leave it at 6 o'clock, because I, for one, can't make a 6 o'clock meeting on a regular basis. It's as simple as that, because on every other Thursday evening, I have a meeting of the ZBA in Wellfleet, which I'm going to attend rather than come down here for this thing at 6 o'clock. And I don't mean that as a threat, but I use it as an example of the kind of problem that we face as members. And I know a number of others of this board who face the same kind of issue. So I, for one, hope that the body will be consulted when the time of meetings is changed in the future, rather than having it just dropped on us. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, if I may, I think we're missing the point of Roger's point of order, the fact that who has the authority to change the time, and under what circumstances can the time be changed? I think that was basically what he was speaking to.
Thank you. Mr. Eby, would you like to add a few?
Did you want to say something?
Oh, sorry. Speak up.
Just to address the basic question of when the time for a meeting can be held, it can be held for the time, as long as you're in accordance with the open meeting law, the time that you post it to be. So we are in accordance with that. I think one thing in particular about post or having it at this time was Roy, you were right in raising the fact that the ad hoc committee that met raised that as an issue and proposed that as a potential to change the time. So that is one of the places it came from, was from a subcommittee of the commission itself.
But if the subcommittee had reported to the whole and let the whole vote on the action, that I have no objection to. But to have it imposed on us, I think was wrong.
I agree with Roger, and I apologize. Take full
that takes all the wind out of my sails.
No, I do. It was an ad hoc committee that met, and the purpose of it really is to try to make, to work on membership. And you know, I had this discussion with the executive committee earlier this week that there is, in many respects, a leadership gap on the Cape, and we're trying to pass the torch. We're trying to make participation as a member of the Cape Cod Commission available to people who can't make 3 o'clock meetings on a Thursday. And so that certainly the intent behind this was just to have a more well-rounded and diversified Cape Cod Commission, especially where we have had so much difficulty lately filling vacant positions. So the ad hoc committee met, and we've been trying to do a number of things. I mean, the Mullen role relying on hearing officers. All of this is really to fill that gap, because we are in serious jeopardy with some of the big projects coming down. If we can't staff subcommittees, if we can't get a quorum to vote at a commission meeting, and we wind up giving a constructive grant to one of these projects that comes through here, it would be the ultimate embarrassment to the Cape Cod Commission. It would be, you know, it would be a mark on a 20-plus year record that would just be unforgivable. And we can't do that. Now, I can't make towns appoint people. And I know that some of these towns have gone out and really actively tried to recruit individuals, and we just had a Harwich member appointed this week, and very thankful for that. But an example is that, even as we try to move forward with the wastewater discussion in Harwich and Chatham, there's been a breakdown in communication. We haven't had Harwich and Chatham representatives at the Cape Cod Commission. We have a Falmouth representative. We have two, kind of. So the same wastewater issue happens in Falmouth that happens in Harwich and Chatham, and we don't have a problem in Falmouth. We have a problem communication-wise in Harwich and Chatham. So the membership of this board is extraordinarily important, and the towns have to participate and be members and be represented and be part of what we do. But I understand, given the amount of the workload that you have on this board, I mean, it's basically at least a part-time job, and we throw incredibly copious amounts of information at you and ask you to digest complex information on a regular basis and make really tough decisions in the best interest of Cape Cod. So it's not something that everybody wants to do. It's not something that everyone has the stomach for. But I know that there are people that would participate if they could, but they can't because they've got a young family and they work. And the change in the time was only meant to go in that direction. I think the ad hoc committee considered that, as well as other sort of ways that we could make this easier for a more diverse group of individuals to volunteer and serve. But Roger's right. You know, there certainly was an intent to survey members, and that recommendation should have been brought to the full commission before a change in time was made, and I accept full responsibility for that decision, and I apologize.
Thank you. Yes, sir.
I would like to comment on the fact that the ad hoc committee knew about this, but the majority of us did not know about why this decision had been made. And I think if some sort of a communique had been sent out so that we were apprised of the fact that the change had been made, because it would have helped considerably.
Well, we can still do that.
Well, I can't really do it now. We're already here.
I am in agreement, and again, my apologies for not having done that. I will say that there was a time when it was easier to get the commission at an annual strategic planning session, for example, where these kind of things were discussed. The last two attempts at that have been dismally attempted. Fewer than five members of a 19-member board showing up 2 years in a row for strategic planning sessions where we would discuss this. So it certainly is not for a lack of effort. But I do apologize, given the reality and the lack of quorum, for not making sure that there was proper communication. I get, and I had, you know, wrongly assumed that that would happen, and I apologize.
Mr. Chairman, if I may, perhaps we should be looking at some kind of criteria and some kind of agreement about when and how and who can change the meeting time. I don't think that would be a big problem, but it probably pays to have something in writing that says this can be done by this person, or this has to be done by the full commission, etc.
I have no doubt that that will happen, Mr. Chair.
Well,
Mr. Director.
To that, I would not want to see the board react in a way that was overly conservative. There are times when we may have to adjust the time of meetings on an emergency situation. So if the scheduling of today's meeting is the reason for that consideration, I would ask you to pause. And what I would suggest is that we do schedule time to get together as a commission that is not here on the dais, so that we can talk about some of these really important issues about the future of this organization and membership.
Yes. Mr. Chair.
Sorry.
Mr. Putnam.
Okay. Excuse me, by the way, allergies have hit me hard this week. Just going off of what I had said earlier, and of course what's been said throughout this room and echoed tonight, including by yourself, you know, membership retention on top of, you know, you had mentioned passing the torch, and that's something that always resonates with me, and I try not to mention it a lot because I know I'm the young guy here, but I know a lot of young people who want to be involved. They just can't make the time. And that's so troubling to me that there are a lot of young people all across Cape Cod. And I can tell you, I know a lot of young people from Falmouth all the way out to Provincetown, you know, and they want to get involved. And some of them come and ask me too. They're like, oh, you're heavily involved in your town. How do I do it here? And I'm like, well, this is what you do. And, you know, you want to look at the times. And then they always come back to me and they go, nope. And I'm like, what's wrong? Well, times. And I'm like, really? And it's kind of, it really is a downer when you think about it, that the people you want to get involved, they're not getting involved because of the time. And I just want to emphasize that point. And I think it would be great if we could have a commission meeting outside this room. I think it would be great if we could get every one of us together to talk about this issue. I feel strongly about getting younger generations involved in local government. And if we can solve that issue, if we can get those vacancies filled, if we can get them filled by people who normally would have never been in those seats, I agree with Paul. We could have a really diverse body here doing a lot of good work. And I think we need to do that.
The discussion has made me think.
I'm sorry.
I thought you were pointing to me.
Ernest.
I agree with Paul. This should be a session where we get to actually discuss this, because I have a lot of concerns that I would like to discuss about this. And nothing against you young fellas, but you need experienced people on this commission who've been on Cape Cod a while, understand a lot of the things that taking place here over a number of years. And you young folks are great, and I appreciate you coming in and getting into it, getting the feel of it, and getting the learning of it. But you gotta understand, you're gonna select people that's got some background and understand the issues and been around a little bit. I'll talk to them next time.
Yes,
listening to the discussion, just thinking of my own. Listening to the discussion and thinking my own situation, I work every day. I come to the Cape Cod Commission meeting no matter when it was, because the Cape Cod Commission is important. But it's far more convenient coming at 6 o'clock for me than it would be at 3. It's almost like you have to rearrange your whole day. It's 6, great time. But if it's not good for the commission, we ought to.
Mr. Chairman,
I think we have to be open in our thought. And, you know, all this generational stuff. I mean, I know a lot of young people that are pretty old, you know, in their. And I know a lot of older people that are, you know, very, you know, up to date and, you know, have a lot to contribute. I don't think it's an age thing, necessarily. There is some aspect of that. But I think we need to be very open about it. I think if we have to go out and find people to recommend to this election, that we maybe ought to do that. But we need to have that participation also. I said enough. Thanks.
Jerry?
Yes, as a member of the subcommittee, we discussed a lot of things, and we discussed that there could be a lot of changes by a change in time. There could be a sea change in the commission based on the fact that some of us, myself included, just don't like to drive at night when it's dark. And maybe that's not a bad thing. I'm not saying it's a bad thing, but the subcommittee really made some recommendations, but we kicked around a lot of thoughts, and some we agreed on, and some we thought might be good, and some we weren't sure would be good, but and it was all subject, of course, whatever suggestions we made would be presented to the full commission.
Yes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Getting back to the basis of this is I do believe we have to get together as a group and have a conversation. I'm not opposed to that. I do also believe we have a responsibility as the commission, whether it's our members here or through staff, that we have to have more conversations with the communities, more direct conversations with the selectmen. If they're the appointing boards, then we have to be very clear about our needs. I don't think that's quite been done, and no offense to anyone, I don't think that's being quite done. And that's how, you know, I belong to our groups that are all about attraction. And what is the attraction? Is there an attraction? Well, the mission's part of the attraction. So we have to promote our mission, what we do. I believe that's what brings people here. I don't think there's an age barrier there. There may be some time constraints, but I'm one of the newer members too when I look around. But what I've realized is in the 4 or 5 years that I've been here, that it's not it's an issue-driven meeting. I'm sorry, I'm a selectman, you know? It's an issue-driven meeting there too. You know, the reality is people will invest their time if there's something that they want to, if there's something that they're interested in, if there's something they are against or for, that's when they show up. If things are working well, they're busy. But I've seen this meeting packed where people were standing because of the issue, not because of the time. So I think that we have to have a general discussion among ourselves of what's best for the commissioners and what's also best for the public. Because I do believe, as a fellow commissioner said, for 15 years, it seems the public has been served. You know, it has been served. And so I understand the apology and all of that, but one of the other things that came out from Mr. McCormick was, I don't know what all these discussions were. I have not a clue what you talked about. So let's have a meeting and have a conversation. So we're all under the same conversation, rather than I see John in the meeting the other day, and he says, oh, I'll see you at 6, and it's like, 6? I haven't got my packet yet, and I probably didn't read the email totally yet, you know? And I said, oh, you know, that's partially my fault, I admit it. But the bottom line is the conversation's all our responsibilities, and let's have that conversation, let's have it relatively soon. And let's pick a time where we can all be there.
Thank you, Glenn.
I want to agree with both Andrew and also Ernie, who are kind of diametrically opposed to one another on their conversations. I agree with Andrew that younger blood in this group would be great. You know, a lot of us who are older don't like to drive at night because we have eye problems, cataracts or whatever, that don't make it easy for us to drive at night. On the other hand, I have to agree with Ernie that you're going to learn from us. You're going to learn from Ernie, not from me. I have been here long enough just to be able to share much with you. But Ernie's been around forever and ever. And that's an extremely important resource for you to have. And the young people are going to be learning from the older members of this group. The younger people will one day be older people, and they will have to confront the same problems with cataracts that John is facing right now. We all are as we grow older.
Okay.
No cataracts? Oh, one to you. I wish I could say the same thing. But I just think that we need a mix of younger and older people, because we're going to learn from one another.
One thing's for sure, this is going to be a lively discussion.
I certainly agree. Are there any further comments?
Mr. Chairman, until that point, are we going back to three?
Yes.
Yes, I don't take sides with the young or the old, because I've been in both positions, now being a very young guy. I started out as an old guy, as an engineer who was trying to put guys on the moon, and we were very young. So I'm not averse to young people being there. Everybody learns. It's being put in the water over your head, and you know what the heck you have to do to get out of it. But I do think that the issues here about the time change is something that we probably missed the boat, but I don't think it was within a malicious intent, just simply the fact that it happened. And I think that the executive director has appropriately apologized, and we do not have to open up the woodshed. So if we finish with that, we will proceed with the next one. Yes, Madam Counsel.
Mr. Chair, if you're completed with that discussion, I would like you to go back to the selection of officers item that's on your agenda. I believe that you delegated the authority to the secretary to cast your vote either in favor or against, but sitting in the back room myself, I did not hear that vote being taken, and because it's posted, you need to do that in open session today, so I would just ask that part of the session to be redone.
So what would you like for me to do?
The slate of officers was nominated and accepted as Jack McCormick chair. It was
Richard Roy,
vice chair, and secretary Andrew Putnam. And if you could please take the vote.
Mr. Chairman, I cast a vote for the nominations as presented.
Thank you.
Is that it?
Yes.
Okay, I don't. Mr. Director, you didn't make. Do you have anything else you want to add? You want to talk to your able replacement, so I think you better worry about the young people.
I do.
Okay.
Yeah, no. We'll catch up with you next time. There's a lot going on, but we will try to schedule a time when we can get together in more of a strategic planning format, even though it certainly won't take a whole day to have this discussion. And my recommendation would be we will revert to the regular meeting time of three until there's a different proposal put in front of the commission.
Thank you.
Just one thing, Mr. Yes. Chairman, I always find a nice luncheon is a way that incentive to bring people in.
I knew you guys.
I would quite agree. Provided there is some champagne.
Mr. Chairman, we don't want the luncheon, though, to last till after dark, because I got to get home.
Right.
I don't know. We'll have to think about that. All right. Are there any other ones we'd like to, any other business?
Move to adjourn, if not.
The motion to adjourn, move and second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Abstained? Thank you.